welcome you to this session. I'm sure we all have interest in looking at empowerment, innovation, and resilience. And I'm sure Nicholas did a good job of explaining to us the key things that we are going to discuss in this session. We have two presentations, one by Nicholas and the other one by Martina. But the issue we are looking at in this session, as we said early in the morning, be looking at the food supply side, the availability of food, what determines that, and we'll be looking at two questions. Can we make innovations more inclusive? We're looking at a situation where we'd like to promote food and nutrition security, and one of the things we need to focus on is productivity. We all know productivity levels are very low, particularly in the areas that we're going to be speaking about, East Africa countries. That's Kenya and Uganda, and Ethiopia as well. So we would like to focus on that issue of productivity. Productivity growth is important, but what are the determinants of that growth? Can we use technology and innovation to improve productivity? And what are the determinants? What are the constraints? We, of course, know the usual ones. We'll be talking about credit, access to information, but what are things beyond access to information and access to credit? And one of the things we'll be speaking about today is what one of the speakers is calling internal constraints, aspirations, psychological drivers. I think that's based on the work in Ethiopia. Are there things beyond what we know that constrain improvement in productivity? And then we'll look at whether technological innovations can enhance economic resilience of farm households. And again, the second speaker will be speaking to that, and we will discuss what's coming out of that as she looks at maize intensification in Kenya and how that interacts with climate change, and how does that affect the economic resilience of farm households. So again, I welcome you to this session. I'm happy to be your moderator. My name is Lilian Kirimi from Tegemeo Institute of Agriculture Policy and Research in Kenya. We are also pleased to have an opening policy statement by Bernard Ray, who is a GD DEFCO. We'll give him some minutes to make some statements before I invite the speakers to give us highlights of the work we have done. Welcome.
Thank you. I don't know if it's the best to stand in front of you. Anyway, good morning and thank you for this invitation. I don't have a PowerPoint. I'll spare you this this effort. But just to thank Food Secure to have brought to the attention the question of innovation. And really, what I will try to do through this brief policy speech is to highlight what innovation in agriculture means for a DG of the European Commission, which is in charge of implementing the development policy of the Union. I have brought a document there, which is on the table. You are free to take a copy, which is really much on the approach we take on research and innovation in food and nutrition security and sustainable agriculture. It develops probably in a more extensively on what I'm going to say, but it's very much in the light. So the innovation, yes, it's an idea which is put into practice with success. Why does it matter for DEFCO? Well, first of all, because we have an operational obligation in the DG in charge of our development policy. We need to make sure that the resources that we bring is useful to attain a number of development objectives. And it's very clear that without innovation, without changes, we shall not, or we will not attain our development objectives. So, if you imagine that for the EU, food and nutrition security, sustainable agriculture is the first, by its size, by its importance, the first sector of intervention of the EU in its development policy. It gathers about 20% of the resources made available for our development policy. It's a sector which will be implemented in 65 countries, and it's roughly, it's more than €1 billion a year in grants to these 65 countries. So, and all the work streams which we have as priorities in these 65 countries, where we want the whole to be more than the simple sum of the parts, is around four work streams. The first one is agriculture as an engine of growth and jobs. It's on the agenda in Europe, it's in the agenda in many developing countries. You know, the Commission has launched earlier this month an initiative on the European investment plans in the fight against forced mobility and migration. It's obvious that we need to have innovation on two aspects there. On one aspect, around the value chain, beyond agriculture, but very much in the whole process of development of the value chains. And we also need financial innovations. Very clearly that it will be with new financial tools, blending loans and grants, taking the financial system, bearing part of the risk which is on agriculture. All these are new practices which will need to be tackled. Our second work stream is to accelerate the reduction rate of stunting, the chronic malnutrition. There has been commitments of Commissioner Piebalgs on that respect. This requires, and the Lancet series are very clearly shown that health, human health, can only cope with about 20% of the variance on stunting. So the question is, what about the remaining 80%? Is it only water and sanitation? And it's also nutrition-sensitive agriculture. And here we have, it's a new venture where we lack evidences and where new technologies, new changes, I mean, I'm thinking of the sweet potatoes with orange flesh, rich in vitamin C, and rice, which has been bred with some minerals. All of these bring into this nutrition agenda. Our third work stream is that the Commission has overall committed that 20% of its budget will be climate relevant. If we want this overall objective reached, DG DevCo needs that 40% of its agricultural investment be climate relevant. We are currently, we have raised our percentage of investment development projects which are climate relevant from 7% 5 years ago to 29, so we are on good track. But this requires new ways of approaching the adaptation challenge, the mitigation challenge in developing countries, how the two are intermingled and they cannot really be split. And we have Marrakesh in a few weeks ahead of us. It's clear that agriculture will be there at the core of the discussion in Marrakesh. The fourth work stream is the resilience to food crisis and the linkage between what DG ECHO, humanitarian assistance, does and the development assistance. This requires many new social innovations, some economic innovations, mutualizing food reserves, grain reserves, like it is being done in West Africa. All of this requires new ways of working. So, can we in this context foster, and I think this is your question, Chair, Moderator, can we foster a science-based agricultural development? This paper comes a little bit on that topic, which how do we approach? It's clear that the rural transformation, the development of agriculture requires enhancing, building the capacity to design and implement at local level, at national level, new mechanisms, new ways of doing business. We cannot do business as usual. So what we do finance at the moment around science and innovation is being financed from a development money. we are not financing, and we have colleagues here from DGRTD, they finance research. That's their business, that's their job. In DGDevCo, we finance development, but we need to involve science in the development that we finance. And this is a challenge in itself, which is a different one from the one of my colleagues. So what are a few entry points? Of course, the first one is that we are, with development money, focusing on putting research into use. It's being called the last mile, can be called the last loop. Anyway, the point is that, I was at the CIMIT 50th anniversary, the heirs of Norman Borloo insisted that bring it to the farmers. I think we are on the same wavelength there. And there are new strategic directions which have to be explored. And we are working through some of our projects to explore new ways of bringing the knowledge to the farmer with the scientific system, like the CGIAR, but also with other actors. The second way we look at science and innovation is that it has to be embedded in the national development agenda, the science-based agricultural development. If it is not within the science, the national system, if it's not to deliver impact at the local level, at the national level, we miss our target. A fourth priority for us is that there is a very strong, and I think FoodSecure demonstrates it, there is a very strong European leadership already in agricultural research for development. And we need to foster that leadership. We need to foster this influence of European institutions. We need to foster the coordination. And in the time that where we see a redesigning of the international architecture of agricultural research for development with the evolution of the CG, new actors coming in, it's important that European players are with DG Development to influence this architecture, which has a bearing on the use of development money. And then, of course, we have this major institutional setup, like the CG, like the Pillar 4 of CADEP with FARAH and the other related institutions. We have to make sure that these contribute to this renewed architecture and that they do bring economies of scale and that they do not correspond to additional layers, but that they bring efficiency gain. The world is more and more complex, it's more and more connected, and we need to have institutions which answer to this more complex and more connected world. The last mile, maybe a word on the last mile with development money. We have been following a number of processes. I mean, I can mention the Dublin process, which we really called. The African Union is a very strong partner from the European Union. We are involved in a high-level policy dialogue at the moment on science for agriculture. But the Dublin process, which was pushing the CGIAR to work more with the African Union institutions, was a very good sign. And I think this is something that today, with the evolution of the site integration of the CGIAR, is an evolution which is interesting to us. We have been supporting innovation platforms. Maybe not at a sufficient scale, but we have a wealth of expertise on innovation platforms in Africa in particular, which is to be valued. But there are some lessons. The lesson is that innovation emanates from many interactions with many development actors. Farmers' organizations and new players exist. The institutions are there. So how do we promote an improved quality of the stakeholders' decisions? I think this is where we are, which use better knowledge and experience in their decision. So this brought us to support financially the concept of agricultural innovation systems. Agricultural innovation systems is a concept which was designed to deliver innovative development solutions through a multi-stakeholder elaboration and preparation process. Essentially, it goes away from a linear traditional model where you have the generation of technology, it is on the shelf, it is promoted with extension service, advisory services, even the new players of advisory services, and then there is a diffusion. It goes away from this focus on productivity, but really to look at with a number of objectives, which are the social objectives for agriculture and the role that agriculture plays in society. How do we foster that? So the components of agricultural innovation systems, it's involve the research bodies, the education bodies as well, the institutions, the business, the enterprises, and the new actors in advisory services. And that includes small farmers as business makers, as business holders. Bridging institutions, which we very often forget, and the various platforms and stakeholders. And of course, acting also on and thinking on the policy environment and acting upon it, both in practices, in the mindsets, and in the attitude. This innovation system, at the moment, we are supporting in 8 countries in the framework of the Tropical Agriculture Platform, which was a G8 initiative. And we work with FAO and with AgriNatura, which is the collective of the European research institutions. And I'm very happy, I was informed last week that FAO, on the basis of the resources that we bring on 8 countries, has gathered money to do it in more countries. So to conclude, innovation is key. It's key in the face of the complexity of the SDGs, and they can be achieved only if availability of knowledge is ensured. It's key for productivity gains, but also for a wider development and sustainable agricultural process, and not only productivity. DEFCO wants to use agriculture research as a lever to enhance innovation at farm level, alongside the value chains, in territories, taking in the spatial dimension as well. And there is a strong complementarity of what DEFCO finances with what the GRTD finances. But we also have loops between the two of us. And I just want to recall that in the work program of Horizon 2020, 2 years ago, we had one particular issue on innovation systems, because we thought it was very important. And yet you see, we bridge between our two financial instruments. And finally, we commit as DEFCO to take advantage of the European expertise in agricultural research for development and to foster the linkages of this expertise with the expertise and the knowledge of our counterparts for development of an agriculture which is sustainable under the 3 pillars of sustainability, the environmental, the social, and the economical. And I thank you very much.
Issues that he touched on, and I'm sure some we have had in the morning, but I just want to emphasize what he has said, that innovation is key not only for productivity gains, but also for broader agricultural growth. And what we should be thinking about is whether science, can we have, or can we foster science-based agricultural development? And we'll be looking in this session at decisions that are made at the farmhouse level. And with that, I'd like to invite Nicholas to give us a presentation, broad views or statements regarding the work they've done on whether we can make innovation more inclusive. Thank you. We'll have Nicholas, and then Martina will follow. After that is when we'll allow time for questions and clarifications.
Thank you, Lillian. So, yes, a few things, a bit of food for thought already in this opening statement. And I think as a first sort of a link with the work that I will present here, I would like to say that it targets directly and plays directly into this first priority that that you have mentioned on agriculture as engine of growth and job creation. The way that people think about their life in agriculture is key to that, obviously. And the presentation that I will give now is going to touch and will actually go quite deep into that. So I'm talking here about psychological drivers of agricultural innovation and the linkages with food security in rural Ethiopia. I will introduce some of the work that was done under the Food Secure Project with different colleagues investigating specific drivers of the diffusion of agricultural innovation, in particular at the farm level. And we tackle innovation creation, and I have to make that comment that we do tackle innovation creation and agricultural innovation systems in other segments of the project for whose research I'm actually not presenting today at a more macro level. Yeah. Of course, innovation diffusion, adoption, or adaptation is not the panacea, but I think it's nonetheless a key element for improved performance of smallholder farmers in very poor regions. And I don't think diffusion is necessarily something that is linear. There are very many different models of diffusion. So globally, we have evidence that agricultural innovation and technological change are major drivers of output growth. The share of agricultural output growth that is not due to using more inputs, but to using better these inputs, is about 3/4 between 1990 and 2010. So, very important contribution, but this contribution varies sharply when you're looking at different regions and countries. And indeed, some of our colleagues in the project have found evidence of very strong disparities in the trajectories to the agricultural productivity frontier. They find that, in fact, the hypothesis that we can find in the economics literature of convergence to the productivity frontier does not always hold. And while this is clearly the case that it holds in OECD countries, you can see that over the period 1960 to 2010, the colleagues have found that actually we find divergence from the frontier. So these poor countries are falling further and further away from the productivity standards. So that's the lesson from that slide. So the question we ask is, can agriculture agriculture innovation diffusion and adoption help the poorest farmers? Or if you want to put it in a corollary, why do the poor not invest more in agricultural innovation? And we have a set of traditional or external constraints that have been very well researched and identified in the literature. So I put a few examples here: access to inputs, markets, knowledge, information, or even the sort of risk and time preference profile of these farmers. All these are elements of the answer. But beyond these external constraints, why two farmers facing the exact same situation behave differently? And this brings us to the theory of aspirations. According to this theory, the poor do not invest in innovation because of aspirations failures. So for different reasons, poor smallholder farmers fail to aspire to change. Aspiration failures are related to two concepts that I'm going to be using later on in the presentation, so I'll introduce them now. It's the concept of aspiration window, so the world that these farmers know, the sort of reference group that they have, which sort of determines where the aspirations are going. And the concept of aspirations gap, so basically a difference between what they aspire to and what their current status is. In our research, we really want to explore the links between farmers' aspirations and the adoption of agricultural innovations, and also later on their food and nutrition security status, as I will show. We start here with the link to innovation. So we recorded the farmers' adoptions in terms of a large number, 12 different value chains innovations, so that will also play into one of your key concepts, the concept of value chain. And we ask that question, in the past 5 years, have you changed something in dot, dot, dot? It can be the choice of a seed, it can be a type of input, it can be the quantity of inputs that they apply, it can be the type of practices that, agronomic practices that they adopt, etc. What you can see in the figure is that the normalized value of the innovation index, which we have on the right hand side, so we normalized it to 1. So how many, basically reflecting how many of these 12 innovations were adopted. And you can also see that the share of the households, that's the other three columns, here, here, and here, that's the share of the farmers who adopted these innovations is clearly related to the level of aspiration of the household head. You might say, these differences are not very big, but yet they are all statistically significant. Now, if we want to translate these differences in terms of what that means in practice, in terms of farmer behavior, well, for this, we need to use different instruments than these distributed statistics, and we run a number of regression models. And what we find is that a large aspirations gap, so when the farmer is very far away from what he aspires to have, this is related to about 23 to 28% reduction in the innovation index. So people are like about a quarter less innovative. We also find that a large or a narrow aspirations gap, this is also very important, because if you are very close to where you want to be, you have very little incentives to change something. This is related to a 105 kilogram decrease in fertilizer being applied per hectare. And this out of a mean application in the region of 170 kilogram per hectare. So it's about 60% reduction. So very substantial effects. So this was for our impact on innovation. Looking now at as the next step to establish the relationship between aspirations and food and nutrition security, we considered four indicators of food and nutrition security, because it is a very multidimensional issue. So they are all pretty, I only present three, yeah, but they are all pretty well accepted indicators. So per capita calorie consumption per day, the food consumption score of the household, there's also the household diet diversity score, and this one is the household food insecurity access score. So what are our main results here? Well, you can see that with all the measures, except maybe this column there, food insecure households also display low aspirations for both the household head and for the spouse. So the same question applies again. Do these differences really matter in practice? So when we start considering a whole lot of factors influencing the outcome simultaneously, so this regression analysis again, we find in particular that one standard deviation in the aspiration index of the household head leads to an increase in 200 kilocalorie per capita per day being consumed in a household, so about plus 6.5%. This is quite substantial. We find plus 4% increase in the food consumption score. We find a plus 2% increase in the household diet diversity score. And we find a almost minus 40% decrease in the food insecurity access score. So very substantial impacts on food and nutrition security indicators. The one big surprise that we got, this analysis we expected to be very strongly gender differentiated, as these statistics here tend to show. We found no impact on the aspirations of the mothers. And this was really a puzzle to us. Yet what we really found is that if you take the aspirations of the mothers out of the equation, out of the analysis, the impact of the aspirations of the household head on food and nutrition security decreases by about 40%. So for some reason, we were not able to capture this impact of the mother's aspirations directly, But if you take the mothers out of the equation, you find that the impact of aspirations decreases a lot. So they do play a role. It could be that they play a very indirect role through their influence on the husband. So what are the main policy messages that we get from this work? Two messages. At the macro level, there is a need to support global agricultural productivity growth and the diffusion of innovation to countries that are falling very much below the productivity frontier. This obviously may require very differentiated sets of policies according to, let's say, the developmental stage of the different countries. But these micro-level findings can only go some way to identify actually how to do this. We identified in that analysis, for instance, that education plays a very big role in the diffusion of education to least developed countries. But how can we do this? Our findings at the micro level can actually point to some more specific actions. And in particular, what we point out here is that interventions on aspirations may enhance the effectiveness of policies targeting the traditional external constraints to invest in agricultural innovations. And for instance, aspirations raising strategies could support innovation diffusion and creation, as well as food and nutrition security. And these aspiration-raising strategies can take several forms. They have been experimented with in different settings, in different countries. And actually, I think they could be very effective and low-cost interventions to increase agricultural innovation among poor farm households. So, thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you very much, Nicolas. So let's have Martina Rosola also share with us findings on innovation and resilience. Then after that, we'll take questions and comments.
So thank you, Lilian. And I will now present the insight from two studies done at the Graduate Institute, and basically you have the full working paper with more detail on the methodology and more specification in the FoodSecure website. So if you're interested, I suggest also to have a look to the list of working paper, and the same for those presented by Nicolas. So here we talk about innovation and resilience, presenting two case studies with data from Uganda and Kenya. So first of all, why we believe this was important and why we were attracted by the research question in the first place. We all know there is extensive literature, and the IPCC confirmed once again in the 2007 and last report that sub-Saharan Africa is indeed extremely vulnerable to climate change. And in particular, East Africa, climatologists tell us, is strongly exposed to this climate change, to increasing variability in weather, for example, to increasing variability in rainfall pattern. Country in East Africa is also a very interesting feature, that they are characterized mostly by several agroecological zones. So you may have within the same country even up to 8 agroecological zones. In some area, for example, you have bimodal rainfall zone, in some area unimodal rainfall, and so the climatic condition and the agronomical condition may vary quite substantially from one point to the other of the same country. And we will see the implication in this also in the research question. And indeed, what are the implications of this setting for a small order farm family and for their resilience, for their well-being? We look in particular to intensification of production. What we generally mean with that, it can be, for example, intensification in the use of fertilizer, or, and here we look particularly, in intensification in the use of hybrid seeds, or jointly. We know that often when hybrid seeds are used, we also expect they are used jointly with fertilizer. And what are the implications of these intensification of production, that can be in terms of fertilizer, hybrid seed, or both, in the resilience of small order farmers? One first insight, my country, my hybrid seed market. Why I stress this? This is something I learned myself by doing this research. we're talking about East Africa, and I was quite shocked to see how different are the different markets in terms of access and use and adoption of iBrisit. I started through the paper from Kenya with wonderful data collected by the Tegemeo Institute. I'm very happy that Lilian is with us today because she's one of the leaders in this data collection. And actually in Kenya, we have quite a long story of adoption of iBrisit. I don't like really to talk about adoption in Kenya, I like to talk about use, because farmers do adopt. The matter is, if we take one piece of land, what's the share of that land grown with iBrisit? It's not really, do they adopt or not iBrisit? And then, through the research, I moved to Uganda, and I was expecting a similar scenario. In fact, no. I was quite shocked about the low level of adoption, how few farmers adopt iBrisit. And once they adopt, if you look, if you have the intertemporal dimension, there is a nice data set published by the World Bank, you see that the same farmer that 1 year adopt an iBrisit, the next year after may actually abandon it and go back to traditional variety. And this is very strong implication in terms for policymaker when design the policy to reach out those farmers and to analyze what's the impact of adoption of use of iBrisit, but also for the researcher, because that's really changed the way you tackle the research question. So here, for example, you can actually see a typical, like, so here you have the cost of adopting iBrisit and how many people adopt the iBrisit. And you would expect that the cost of adopting is a decreasing function for both traditional and hybrid of the number of people. Why? Because you adopt your iBrisit, how much fertilizer you put on that iBrisit? When exactly do you need to plant that iBrisit? How much water you apply? Let's not forget, in this area, most of the agriculture is actually rain-fed. So if you, and actually a lot of farmers, for example, will irrigate through buckets, so walking in and out the field. So when do you do that? And here, we see, you basically learn. You learn from your peer, and actually Nicholas also providing sidelight. What make farmer aspiring to adopt or not? And here we see that traditional variety are there for very long time. We have lot of adopter, very low cost. What about the improved seed? That potentially they give us more resilience, or potentially they give us more output, but we have very few adopter. So that's actually one of the reasons why we often hear about the Green Revolution in Asia. Dips in many areas did work, but why the same didn't happen in East Africa? And that's actually a very, very simple graph to show one of the reasons, because the level, the number of first adopter is actually, in some country, like Uganda, is actually very low. So you have actually high cost of adoption. What a country can do in this first case, when the number of adopter is quite low. So here we see the case of Uganda, where some policy were actually done. So here we see 94 in Uganda, so that's basically the number of introduced variety of hybrid seed and open pollinated variety. So let's say just improved variety, consider this one group. So Uganda, in 94 we have the exception basically of the TRIPS agreement of the WTO with more protection for those farmers that experiment with seed. So they have intellectual property over the new variety they find. So you would expect that's a good push actually for them. And then also the Ministry of Agriculture in Uganda did some policy to protect intellectual property on those seeds. And indeed, you see that some actual new variety were introduced. And then in 2006, there was even an improvement of this legislation. So now the seed market in Uganda is quite controlled from a legislative point of view. And even like we have different actually level of legislation. So, and we see that the number of variety introduced in the overall market has actually grown quite substantially with this improvement of legislation. So that's the first step. And as a legislator, how do I set the background for those varieties to be there in the first place? And here you see like the case, for example, to Uganda. I have to say, actually most of the new variety, especially in the very last year, has been introduced through also to the work, for example, of NGO, like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, actually introduced quite a few new varieties recently. But once those new varieties are introduced in the market, here we are in the second step, farmers should adopt. It's not enough to protect experimenters. Once I know I can have a new variety, I should still choose, right? I have my hybrid seed and I have my traditional seed. what should I plant in my field? And here I present some insight from actually Kenya, where the variety are there and there is quite a long tradition in adopting. And I say, once farmers adopt this improved variety, what's the impact? We would expect the mean increase of the production. So here we go, like, of course, with all the impact on food security. What about the variance of the production? What about the skewness, the risk of extreme event, the risk of downside event? And that's what we analyze in this paper from Kenya. And that's what I mean with risk exposure. So I adopt a higher share of my field now is with ivory seed. I would expect the mean of my production goes up. What about the variance and the skewness? So the probability of extreme event. And here we build on some theoretical insight from portfolio management, where normally, like when you look at the financial sector, you look at the mean and the variance of your portfolio, and you extend also to the risk of downside, crop failure, which we believe in agriculture is also important. And what we find actually, so here consider that that's my field, and I have to decide how big is this corner with ivory seed. And so here you can model and consider the vertical axis as my downside risk. This captures my variance. We see that for very low variance and for very high variance, skewness doesn't really matter, right? I would still do 100% of my field with ivory seed. So this is 10% with ivory seed, 20, 30, up to 100% of my field with ivory seed. For intermediate variance, the farmer will balance. And you see that if you are here, depending on the variance level, I can move up to, I don't know, I grow like only 70% of my field with ivory seed or 100. So that's just to introduce a bit how the farmer may think in that. And that's also why in literature, there are some papers that found that the downside doesn't really matter. Farmer also only think in terms of mean and variance. Other paper found that was relevant, and that's maybe a scenario. Of course, this line depends on the calibration, which depends on the underlying parameter, and I just thought that those countries are characterized, for example, by many agroecological zones, many different groups, which may indeed impact the parameter. But that's just to provide intuition behind. So if I have to provide some conclusion and messages, so here we say that to have a sufficient number of adopters, it's really key to inform others on the use and efficiency of the new technology. Once I have, I also need to learn how to use, and I need to have a sufficient number of adopters, because I need sufficient experimentation with those seeds. And that's very key for agricultural technology diffusion. So fantastic to have policy that set the legal framework and actually make it possible to diffuse those new varieties. But it's probably actually as important that to also work to the farmer to learn about the experimentation, the need experimentation. Otherwise, we may have kind of lock-in, like in the case of Uganda, where there is a broad set of policy, there are availability, but there is very, very low adoption. And then in Kenya, we actually find that hybrid seeds, hybrid maize seed, has a positive impact on the mean output, as we all would have expected. We do not find actually evidence that they increase exposure to income variability, the variance of output, and downside risk. So in our case, we would say that it's important the promotion of maize hybrid, and it's valuable, especially when those hybrid seeds prove strong to a variety of underlying conditions, which are actually a wide range of conditions, which is quite important if you think in a country like Kenya, where you have like eight different agroecological zones, some area with bimodal rainfall, some area with unimodal rainfall. So quite a range of conditions if you want to do a policy or a reach out at country level. Here's something I learned, and I think it's important also for those policymakers. Maybe some of you is involved in designing the very first stage of those interdisciplinary program. So promote collaboration between fields. Of course, as I said, use, for example, for the Kenya paper, the wonderful data set done by Tegemeo in collaboration with Michigan State University. But as we just heard also in the previous talk, climate climate funds is very, very important to link climate and agriculture. So then I had to work with climatologists to actually match climate data, weather data at given location with this farm level data. So that's an example of interdisciplinary collaboration between economists, political science, climatologists. Collaboration between borders, so, and that's also a matter of understanding, here I mean basically understanding your context, understand the country. And that's, as I say, I was quite shocked at first to learn about the huge difference between Kenya and Uganda in terms of adoption, which were totally unexpected to me at first. And then, of course, through the value chain, right? You have some, you go from the policymaker who has to do policy to reach out, to promote, for example, the diffusion of hybrid seed. And then you go all the way down, the researcher that analyzes. And I really like what was said before of doing like really like research that then you can implement. So how then the researcher get to know all this structure, how the farmer adopt, how the farmer experiment. And so really think about in terms of value chain and not a single agent. And so thank you very much.
The question that Nicholas posed was, why don't poor households use agriculture innovations? And he used the theory of aspirations and aspiration failures, and indeed indicated in his work that aspirations matter in practice, and we see that there is a linkage between food insecure or food insecurity at the household level and low aspirations. So the issue of addressing those internal constraints as just opposed to the usual external constraint we think about, access to credit, access to information. And then for Martina, she looked at innovation and resilience. And the question she was asking is whether intensification can be a useful adaptive strategy to climate change. And as we have seen, one of the things that came out that there's low adoption of hybrid, she used maize hybrid seeds as a case of intensification and or innovation. But in some cases, like she brought out in Uganda, there's low adoption of hybrid seeds, an indicator that there's need for sufficient experimentation. Farmers need to learn and continuously use the innovations to improve productivity. But also in her conclusion is that use of hybrid maize, at least in the case of Kenya, is potentially a valuable adaptation strategy, particularly if those hybrid varieties are well adapted to a wide range of conditions. And now I would like to have your responses. I see Professor Sura is already, his hand is up. We'll start with Prof. Then, sorry, of course, I don't know your names. So you'll be second, third, fourth, and fifth. Let's start there.
First of all, let me commend the center for a very innovative kind of research. But my question is, what are the factors which affect aspiration levels? I've been quite worried, because aspiration levels, we hope to know the factors which affect the aspiration levels before we now measure the connection between aspiration and adoption. Okay. That's a very important. That sequence of determinants or discussing this kind of modeling is important, because we don't know. I mean, for example, how do you measure aspiration? If the farmer or an individual doesn't know what to aspire to, then of course it's very difficult to say aspiration matters in terms of the adoption of technology. The other issue, just in short, is the issue of adoption of technologies. How, to what extent is institutional failure affecting adoption? For example, there could be a stop-go kind of approach for farmers. They adopt, next time the fertilizer they buy is adulterated, and therefore they stop. They get discouraged completely. They don't want to buy the fertilizer anymore, or seed for that matter. So, and in our parts of the world, there's a lot of institutional failures where farmers get, I mean, buy adulterated seeds or fake seeds or fake fertilizer. How do you deal with that? The aspect of institutional failure.
Okay, let's go to second.
Yeah, I'm Hans Lutzer from DG Research and Innovation. If I take your two presentations together and try to draw some conclusions for a policy, I would say that the approach which we have adopted a few years ago, the multi-actor approach, where we try to bring different actors together, where farmers are one, and researchers or advisors or small and medium enterprises, which are important in the food chain, probably we are quite on the right track. Because I think, as you pointed out, for hybrid seeds, you need to know whether a farmer is delivering to the miller, where, for example, storage quality doesn't play a role. But if a farmer is keeping his seed for the next year, maybe for a period of food insecurity, where storage quality plays a huge role, and there sometimes traditional varieties are better performing. So you need to know a lot of characteristics, actually, and objectives of a farming household, what he expects to do with this harvest. And if we take this multi-actor approach, then we would have, if it's a dairy farmer, we would have, let's say, advisors, milk companies, and the whole package of the food chain involved in an innovation approach. And therefore, I think if I draw a conclusion for our research and innovation policy, which we also want to implement in the high-level policy dialogue, EU-African Union, which Bernard Ray mentioned, that the multi-actor approach is probably, we are quite on the right track.
Thank you.
Yep.
Next.
Ruud Ruben, Wageningen University. In fact, I was a little bit doubtful to go to this session because we have about 50 PhD theses a year about adoption. So I was wondering, can you bring something new? And I think you did, because you have focused a little bit more on the demand side, I think, from innovation and adoption. Nevertheless, in my view, there is a paradigm shift behind what you are telling us. In the past, much of the adoption innovation was very much supply-driven. So it was the seed industry or it was the financial agents. But at the very end, your last slide, Martina, you mentioned value chains. And I think that is really very important. My hypothesis after hearing all your stories is that farmers that are best and most related to markets, to value chains, that have contracts, for instance, have lowest risk, and therefore they have more ability to adopt. But still, you look at all farmers at the same side. So my question is, aren't we just focusing too much on the poorer part of the smallholder farmers for this adoption studies, and shouldn't we look at those farmers that are far more market related? And that would also avoid, because if you look at the Ethiopia study, the best farmers in adoptions are those that have off-farm employment, I saw in the paper. So that is a relationship with another market, the labor market. So perhaps we should be more restrictive, not focusing on everybody. That's my question.
Okay. Okay,
thank you for the presentations. I think it was, my name is Hanna Saarinen, and I work with Oxfam International here in Brussels. I think bringing in the psychological dimension to the debate, I think that's very innovative and important as well. But the presentation left me wondering, how is the cause and consequence being analyzed? Like, which one is actually causing and which one is the consequence? And is the relationship linear or is it maybe circular? So how do these points affect one another? Because it's certainly quite a complex picture as a whole. And another point is, I felt that this analysis put a lot of responsibility on the individual. But that's a whole another debate, how much we are actually individually able to make decisions in our lives. Here in Western cultures, we tend to think that it's individualistic. We are the masters of our own lives. That's very debatable. And when we even go to Ethiopia, which is a very, very difficult country context, I think the whole society and how it plays on individuals. How was that taken into consideration?
Okay, let's have the.
I think I can make it very short because it goes the same line than my three decessors in speaking. I want to know if we should not have more disaggregation. You had, Nicolas, the gender aggregation, saying the mothers and the spouses and the farmers, but I think maybe this is not enough. We need to see if the female-headed households, if what age are the farmers, or how is the composition of the farms, they will take different decisions. If you really want to know what drives them and what is their aspiration, I think you need to go much in a much broader picture, and social status, culture, and so on. This also needs to be taken into account to really see what matters for them. Why do they take the decisions they are taking? That was mainly to see that it needs more disaggregation.
Okay, now it looks like we have only one round of questions, so let me allow you to say the last one, and then we perhaps get the response.
Two very important studies. The literature on adoption really doesn't have a lot of psychology, so this is a great first stage. I think one thing that we know is that there is a heterogeneity among people. Not all people are the same, and always there are differences between adopters and non-adopters. One key question is what type of intervention one can develop to address these issues in terms of, and how you link all these issues of self-esteem with human capital, because we know that low human capital is associated with less lack of adoption, and that education and training, even short-term training, can work. So how supply chain, extension, other activities can really help farmers to gain confidence, and how also working in thinking.
Okay, we'll allow Thomas and Martina to respond briefly because.
So, in 10 minutes, they start the next session.
Yes.
Martina goes
first, okay.
I go first.
All right.
Yep. No, I go first, okay. I sit down. Willis, factors affecting aspirations. Yes, we do consider them, not in these papers that I presented here, but. That's part of the doctoral research of my students. So once his PhD is out, you will have more answers on this. One big element that we have there is the role of social networks. I think, Mr. Lutzai, I leave your question to Martina. Yours as well. I'm with the next one. The cause and effect relationship. This is very difficult. I've been very careful not to mention it at any point in the talk here because this is cross-section data. So for this, we need to go back and ask the same questions again. There is no survey that routinely asks questions about aspirations or psychological drivers of innovation or things like this. So we started from scratch, and this was the first round. So you need more to be able to then find out in which way the causal relationships are going. A lot of responsibility put on the individual, yes. At the same time, a big component of the research there, as I indicated about Willis' comments, is to look at the role of collective action or to look at the role of community networks in developing knowledge and exchanging with each other. So this is also another part of the research I did not present today. Of course, we were active in the Oromia region in 2012. I would guess that if we go there and ask the same questions about something as shifty as psychological feelings, yeah, we would get very different answers now. I have another student who works at the determinants of the occupational choice of youth in rural areas and what their expectations of the future play as a role to stay in agriculture or to leave agriculture, also in the state of Oromia. I would imagine that we would also get very different answers right now. So just as a side comment, the gender desegregation, too little, we need to know more about the farm structure. This is all part of the confounders or the other factors that we take into account that were not put in any of the slides there, because our regression tables are about this long. So we do look into this. What kind of intervention can we promote, and how does that link to human capital? Vocational training is one of the things that our institute is also looking into in the context of another project, so I fully agree with this, David. linking how people think about their occupation to basically the state of their human capital and how we can improve it is another avenue for research that we're also getting into. The kind of interventions, I mean, some researchers have had some interventional aspirations in different settings. The one that I'm most familiar with is the one in Ethiopia, but I think in India there's been quite a lot of research on this as well. And it can be very simple things. So first of all, to expand your aspiration window. Who do you know? What do they do? And what can you take from that? So basically increase the network, bring examples of successful farmers to be discussed within farming communities. Yeah. In India, it also has much more sort of basic interventions like women's group, bringing all women together into a room and teaching them, yes, you can. Yes, we simply in sort of psychological workshops, if you want. So let them know that they can achieve something, yeah, if they put their mind to it, and not all barriers are there all the time, yeah. So these are some examples, and they are there in the literature. And I stop here.
Yes, please. Yeah. Thank you, Kevin. A very quick round of answers. So on the first point of institutional failure, and I really like the example of fake seeds, because I think you really touch upon an important point, and actually we face that problem, for example, in Uganda. There is another set of authors, I cite the working paper, it's still a working paper for them too, in the paper, that actually they could go and test the seed. So they were pretending to buy ivory seed, then they would test, and they saw that the percentage of fake seed was huge, was quite impressive. And indeed, if you are a poor farmer, you invest your money, you buy. But actually, in the paper, we tackled this, confronting about certification. So what the adoption of certified seed, or just declared quality, or seed that... So the role of certification and, for example, extension agent in helping the farmer can be really key. And in some countries, still really a big barrier, like in the case of Uganda. And if someone is interested in this other paper, I can provide citation. I just don't have on top of my mind the author's name. And for the fact of looking also, not just at the poorer, but also a bit upstream, more commercial farmer, I think you're right. And I think we are going a bit in this direction. The second comment about the fact that the European Union is starting to look at multi-actor approach, I agree, and that's actually was one of my key messages. That's great, so let's continue on this path. And for example, right now I'm involved in a project in Zimbabwe, also sponsored by the European Union, where we actually look at more commercially oriented farmer in the horticultural sector. So it starts also, that is, there are funds, the EU is actually starting to look also into that and really focusing also more commercial farmers. I think it's such a quite an important point. On the point, and here, that's why I'm here, I wanted to quickly show on the comment of looking broader, sorry, but that's why I'm there was a comment about important education, women-headed, and I just want to say the result are based on regression result, where those variables were taken into account. Like, for example, here on the impact of the level of education of men and women in the household, or the fact that the household is headed by a female-headed household. And indeed, in the case of just to give an example of the set of variables, and which they are included in the regression result, just for sake of time, we didn't present. And for example, in Kenya, interesting, we really see a barrier for female-headed household, and Lilian on this could eventually elaborate even better than me, but we actually then look with the local team, why so? And because most of the female-headed also are widow. So then if we can understand better the context of fragility also, those specific households, and then what's the key needs respect to other households. So thank you.
Thank you. So I think we'll bring it to a close here. But let's put our hands together.